many of you know, I hope, that March has been set aside as Women's History Month, and that's to take some time to think about the contributions that women have made to our city, to our state, to our country. We often think about all the wonderful things men have done, and now it's time for women to change our name, and we chose a woman. And we are especially fortunate because our woman is still has been so gracious on so many occasions to come and meet with students and come to our science expo, come to the moving on ceremony for eighth graders, come to our Middle Ages fair. And many of you know a lot about her. Many of you may not have been aware of some of the things. Starting off, she was an extraordinary student all the way through. She has been an educator, a wife, a mother. She has been a community leader and recognized with awards. A wife, a mother, and she has even been a queen. She was the queen of our Middle Ages fair 3 years ago. So, she is here today to share some of her experience.
I'll pull it together. Think what a wonderful thing that would be. I'll put it all. Do you think that might stop wars?
On behalf of women, and to share some of her very personal experiences. She's had a very interesting life, and we're happy to have Mrs. Velma Hamilton.
When I was first asked to come over, I thought that this was just in celebration of women's history, and I could go back and talk about all the women who had contributed and so forth, and the glass ceiling that we talk about these days. You know what the glass ceiling is? It's the attempt to limit the contributions of women who have prepared themselves as lawyers or as doctors or whatever, as business people, to say, well, you can get so far, but you can't pass this. You know, you're limited, no matter how well educated you are, etc. And that is something that some of us are very eager to have destroyed. We don't believe in the glass ceiling, that if people are well prepared for a particular profession, they should be encouraged to participate and to use their talents in that direction. But then she switched on me. And so it's very disconnected, and I'll just ramble around and tell you a little bit about myself and let you ask questions if I don't touch on some things that you're interested in. I mentioned the fact, I think, earlier that I am recently a widow. Now, the continuation of certain of our dreams and ambitions in the world today. We have one son and two daughters. Our son is in California. He is the vice president and provost of Chapman University out at Orange, California. Our older daughter is an administrator in the School of Osteopathic Medicine in Athens, Ohio. And our younger daughter is a specialist in early childhood education at Yale University in New Haven. I mentioned the places, it shows how spread out we are. We cover the continent, really. And it's very hard on mother to be here alone, and it results in quite heavy telephone bills because we do keep in touch. But that's the that's the story of the Hamiltons here. Our kids were products of what was then Nokomis School. It's now Thoreau. they went, and I guess Muriel was the only one who went to Cherokee Middle School because it wasn't built when the others were ready for it. And I guess this was not a middle school, it was a junior high at first, wasn't it? I believe it was. And then they went on to West, so all three of them graduated from West High School and went on to college. Our son and his older sister both went to Beloit College, which is my school. And I remember when Muriel was taking her ACT, she came to me one day and she said, "Mom, do I have to go to Beloit?" And I said, "Of course not, you don't have to go to Beloit. You go to whichever college you choose to go to." So that was the way that was, and after the tests were over, it happened that a friend of ours here in Madison was a recruiter for Oberlin College, and that's where she went, to Oberlin in Ohio. And then after that, they have all gone to additional courses and schools. And so I say without some degree of pride, perhaps, but not really, we have 15 college degrees in our family. And it just indicates that we believe in the power of education. And it seems to me that you are on the right track when you come to a good school like this, and that you're just really exploring your possibilities, but that you will continue to develop in the direction that you want to go. And your advantages right now are a little different, perhaps, than when my kids were your age, because we are now in a technological age, and you have that as a possibility. And technology has offered great opportunities for the good life and for understanding the kind of world in which we live, and the ability of people to work together on common problems. So don't overlook the possibilities in technology, because that, I think, is a part of the future. And the nice thing about most of the courses, most of the schools that offer technology, is that they add general education, liberal education, as a part of the requirements, so that you do not lose touch with observations and the successes of the academic world, which are still important to you, even if you go into technology. Okay, so that's the beginning. Now, I think I said this morning, and I'm not repeating, I mean in the same sequence anyway, the fact that I do not consider myself an African-American. That is only a part of my background. I consider myself an American. And it's very significant to me that your school is as I look around, you're fortunate to have a variety of backgrounds touches with the world represented here in your own school, which is good training for you. For a long time, most of our immigrants came from Europe, from England or Scotland or Sweden or France, or right down there, nowhere else. And now we have more representation of the world right here in our own country. And I think that's all to the good. It's toward the betterment of
the world as we know it.
Okay, now why do I consider myself an American? Because some of my ancestors were brought here on slave boats from Europe. But some of them were not. Some of my ancestors came over with
the original colonists. And my maternal grandmother
was the product of a family in Virginia.
And it was not, they were brought over as slaves, but she didn't
end up a slave and was a part of their family. Her name was Bradford, and I think I said this morning, I was in a group, we were talking about Virginia once, and I said, oh, my grandmother came from Richmond, and her name was Bradford. Well, of course, Bradford is one of the rather common names of English people who lived in Virginia. And these people who were visiting Madison at that time, and when I said that, thought, oh, gee, you know, and they were
total quiet.
They couldn't accept the fact that here was a person that was a part of indigenous Virginia. And no need to be ashamed of it, no need to be proud of it. It was just, to me, a statement of fact. And that is a fact that many people will not accept or recognize in this country. On the other side of my family, you have my father's family. His mother was a Cherokee Indian who had been a part of that,
what is it, Parade of Tears?
Trail
of Tears,
that was coming from the East Coast, going over to Oklahoma, where they were going to expect the Indians to settle. And she didn't want to go. And she got only halfway, and then she just left the group. She escaped and went into the closest community that was available to her, which was a town in Mississippi. And it was in this town that she married my paternal grandfather. And so my father was partly Cherokee. I'm saying this because it represents the amalgam of races that we have here in this country. And many, many of us who are part of the population, which is designated in most publications as the as African Americans, we're Americans. And I think that's a point that many young people ought to get to know, that our lineage is in that direction.
And it seems to me also a very good trend that many of the new immigrants are not
from this narrow England, Germany, you know, Scotland, you know, that part of Europe. But many of our new immigrants are from places around the world that were not in that narrow scheme. And that makes it good too, because we have here an opportunity, your generation and others have the opportunity of really living in a world that is one world. That's a possibility. And I hope that you take advantage of that possibility as you get to know people in this school who have a different background than your own, etc., and you find that you can all get along and that you can all learn the same kinds of things that work together to make this a beautiful world that it can be. Okay? Now, that's all background. I should mention some of the experiences I had when I was your age. I used to be that age.
My parents came to Wisconsin
and were looking for the good life, and they came from the South. But they had expected to find in Wisconsin great opportunities for the two children that were in our family. There were just two of us. I had an older sister who was 9 years older than I. And they came thinking that this was the place where their children would have more advantages, better advantages in all kinds of ways, but particularly in education. And they came at during the First World War, actually, about 1915 or 16, in that period. And my father was not well educated. I don't think my father ever went to school a day in his life, but he was very ambitious. My mother was relatively educated, but they had great ideas for their children. And as I say, there were two of us. And I grew up in Beloit, and I went to school there. I didn't go to a middle school, because there weren't middle schools in those days. But I went to a junior high. And junior high was just like, I suppose, senior high, only it had different subjects. I was speaking to someone just this morning about the fact that I had my introduction to foreign language in junior high school. 4 years, the total was 4 years of Latin and 3 years of Spanish and 4 years of French or something like that. But anyway, I was taking Spanish this first year, and it was pretty textbook limited, you know, you just learned the words, etc., but you didn't really speak it. And when we went downtown to the senior high school, we were seated around in the classroom, and there was a table, and there was a book on the table, and the teacher came in, and he said, "Donde esta el libro?" He was looking all around, "Donde esta el libro?" And we thought, what is wrong with this man? You know, what's he talking about? We had not had a teacher who spoke the language. It was a textbook sort of thing, and we just learned the words themselves and with the pronunciation, but it wasn't a realistic sort of experience. And I think that probably typified the junior high school experience. It was not unique in the sense that it was preparing younger people for participation in the world. It was just an academic sort of thing. And we finally, when we went down to senior high school, we finally had a teacher who spoke the Spanish, and we were encouraged to use it, and that made a great deal of difference. Okay, and so that represented one experience of mine in junior high school. I don't think I mentioned this morning, but I remember one of the heartbreaking things that happened to me in junior high school was that I had some friends that we had come from different elementary schools, and I had some friends who were good friends in the classroom. We had no association outside of the classroom. We didn't go to the same, we
we didn't go to the same church, we didn't, you know, we didn't go to participate in the same kinds of activities, but we had somewhat the same ideas. And at the end of the school year, we were all packed to go home. We were taking our books and supplies, etc. And these four or five friends of mine had suitcases, and they were all set to go over to Lake Geneva to a camping experience for one of the organizations I won't name. They were ready to go over there for a 2 weeks vacation, but I was not included, and that hurt. And I shall never forget it, that here they were. We had been good friends in school, but when it came to a camping experience at Lake Geneva, I was not included. And that was one of the first, I think, hurts socially that I remember. But anyway, in high school, I had a good curriculum and made good grades. They organized the National Honor Society while I was there, while I was in high school. Do you have National Honor Society in Madison?
In the high school.
In the high school, yeah. Well, anyway, and I was one of the first classes to, I was one of the first to be accepted into the National Honor Society. And then when I graduated from high school, we had the problem of what to do with who was going to be the valedictorian, who was going to be the salutatorian, who, you know, that sort of thing. And of course, as a student, I never even knew about these, and certainly didn't know about the problems that the committee had to face, but they just couldn't really decide how to do it, because it just didn't seem, it was a new thing to have a minority student be an honor graduate of Beloit High School. It just hadn't ever happened before. And so they had to twist and turn around a great deal. So I think my class did not have a valedictorian or a salutatorian. They had four honor graduates. That made it all right. And so I never really knew what my standing was in the class, except that it was one of the top four. I think the class was 186 or something like that. So that wasn't a bad. My parents were very pleased with it. I went on to college, took the liberal arts curriculum, continued with some languages, took a lot of biology, took some education courses, all things that a liberal arts college would offer, and I did all right there too, and was elected Phi Beta Kappa there, and graduated magna cum laude, which was something that my parents were very pleased about. And I think it did something for some of the other kids in the Beloit community to know that was possible for that to happen to somebody like me. After Beloit College, I'd always wanted to teach, and Beloit had never had a black teacher. They didn't know what in thunder to do, and so I never even applied for a position there. And I was more interested in the higher education, and was the president of the college wrote a lot of letters around to schools in the South that had colleges for blacks. And I was offered a position in Greensboro, North Carolina, which was a private school and for women. And I was able to go there, and it was a good experience for me to go into, although I had to maneuver a great deal to get there without going in a Jim Crow car. Do you know what a Jim Crow car is? It's where you buy your ticket to go somewhere, but if you're of a certain racial group, you sit up next to the engine. You know, it's a segregated car. And my parents didn't want me to have to go through that. So we were able to have a route that would go from Beloit straight across to Washington, D.C., without going into the segregated part of the country, and then to take a Pullman from Washington down to Greensboro, which was not segregated. So that was my introduction to the segregated South. And but the good thing about, there were two good things about it. I did have a chance to see the kind of education that was available at various levels in North Carolina. And I met my husband there the first year that I was there. And I think that justified all the inconvenience of getting there. We did work to, well, make a long story short, we knew each other for 2 or 3 years. I came back to Beloit and to Madison the first year I was out and started my graduate work. And the next summer he came as a summer school student, and that was a continuation of the one night Valentine's party that where we met. And after 3 years, I guess, we were married, and we're married for 61 years. And out of that came the three kids that I've mentioned. But this experience in the South, where we were together for several years working for the American Missionary Association. We are members of the Congregational Church, and it's the UCC here in Madison, if you know it. And there were schools about the South that had been started by the Congregational Church, and they were not segregated schools. And we had opportunity to work in this kind of school until we came here in Madison during World War II. It was during that period when we first came to Madison as a couple, that I worked for the first job I guess I had was with the Armed Forces Institute. Which was here in Madison, which provided correspondence school board for fellows who were in the Army. And I did papers, corrected papers for them on the college level. And then after that, I worked with the University Extension doing the same kind of thing. And then after that, there was the problem of my husband finishing his PhD, and I took a job with what was then called the vocational school, which many people thought was a disgrace that someone with my background would take a job with the vocational school. But I did, because we needed the money, and it was an opportunity for my husband to keep on and finish his degree. And it was, in a sense, a
a good thing for me to get into that, because I had never had any kind of contact with a vocational assistant. And it was in this situation that I was able, after a couple of years, to help to develop the college transfer program for the Voc-Tech system. And I traveled up and down the North Central Association area, all the way down to Texas and over to Minnesota and Michigan and so forth, studying community colleges and finding out what the curriculum was being offered by community colleges, which was a combination, you see, of the technical and the liberal studies. And so as a result of a couple of years of that kind of travel, I was able to help to set up in this city a curriculum which represented preparation for the technical world, but also provided for transfer to a four-year college if you wanted it, that sort of thing. And that was fun to do, and I enjoyed it very much and was very, very happy when we were certified as a technical college. Of course, we really could have been certified as a community college at that point, but the Voc-Tech board didn't want to drop the technical word, and so we became Madison Technical College. But I have seen that grow, and I worked there for until I retired, and I was the head of the liberal studies program there. And that was a very important period of my life, to see how that would mesh into a technological age. I'm very proud of the school, and I think it has great possibilities for the technological age. And there are many people who have made that as a deliberate choice, to go 2 years there or whatever and take a job in the technological age. Okay, so that represents my vocational and professional teaching. It was also interesting that as we decided to stay here in Madison, to participate in the community. And for the first time, I guess I got the idea about it takes a whole community to rear a child, you know, that's that slogan that is now, and participated in all kinds of areas within the city, areas that I had been introduced to when the kids were in school, like the Boy Scouts and the Girl Scouts and, you know, and the YWCA, although I had that in Beloit. But many of the community organizations I became involved in as a citizen, not as a professional worker at all, but just interested in the development of these kinds of things. And as a result, was appointed to several governor's commission on the arts and commission on human rights and the arts board. I sat on the arts board for a while, etc. But that gave me experience with the community, and it gave the community experience with me. It was all good, because that was our idea of being a good citizen, was working in the community to help. And it was not paid jobs at all, it was community volunteer jobs. And as a result, I was the Mother of the Year 1 year for the whole state of Wisconsin, which was kind of interesting. Not for me, but for other people to say, gee, you know, she has a lot of pigment for that. But it was an experience for me and for the state to have a woman like me be the Mother of the Year and represented Wisconsin nationally. We went to New York and had all kinds of fun things to do there as a national experience. So I'm saying these kinds of things to show that participation in the community where you live is as important as your professional work is important. The kind of person you become and the kind of life you live is important. And I think that because of that, I was able to make, a lot of people had for the first time, I suppose, an association with a person like me, and found that I could enjoy Brahms and Bach and other kinds of music just as much as anybody else. And we tried to live a lawful community kind of life, participating and so forth, which in a sense I think influenced a lot of people in this community who had not had the experience of knowing somebody who looked like us. Okay. So I think that's pretty much the way it is. I still believe in the possibilities. I was saying downstairs just a while ago, I think one of the good things about a school like this is that those of you who were not born in this country, and I think I can notice that there are representatives in the school from different countries, you're not all from Europe. It's a good thing that we have spread our influence into other parts of the world so that there is a possibility to develop in this country the realization of the one world concept that we've talked about a while. We can really have a one world if we just work at it. And schools like this that have a representation from, not just from Germany and England and Italy and that sort of place, those kinds of places, but other places, Israel and China and, you know, all places in the world are now represented in this country. And if we can somehow pull it together, think what a wonderful thing that would be for the world. You think that might stop wars? It might. It might. And that's something to work for. And a school like this has an opportunity to feed into that possibility, and that as you get to know each other and work together and so forth, you are really making the world. And I was told that I should repeat the Gettysburg Address. I was saying that when I was in fifth grade in Beloit, we used to take penmanship classes. You don't take penmanship anymore, do you? You print your writing, or you write, but you don't. But anyway, we took, you know, we did these oval things and we did the push-up things and so forth every day. But at the end of the month, we had to be tested on how well we had had learned this kind of writing. And the test was to write from memory Lincoln's Gettysburg Address. And I learned that then, and I think it had a great influence on me and the kinds of hopes that I had for this world, for these United States. And I have not given up on that, although there are many people who have. And it is 80. How many of you know it? 87 years ago, our fathers brought forth upon this continent a new nation.
conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. That they, and I suppose we should say, and women, huh? All men and women are created equal. That they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights. And among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We are now engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation or any nation so conceived and so dedicated can long endure. We're met on a great battlefield of a war. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate, we cannot consecrate, we cannot hallow these grounds. The brave men, living and dead, who fought here have consecrated them far above our poor powers to add or detract. It is for the living to be dedicated to the proposition for which these men died, that they may not have died in vain, and that this nation under God shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, and for the people shall not perish from the earth. Did I get through?